Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs, daily current affairs classes. So today you have 25th of March 2021. All right. And these lectures are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination conducted by the UPSC or Union Public Service Commission. Okay. And for that, you also probably studying the national newspaper like the Hindu and Indian Express. You can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. So you can supplement your preparation, and you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for your better preparation. Okay, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so the first news is related to the Chief Justice of India. As you know, the Supreme Court is basically an apex court in the integrated judicial system of our country. Okay, so we have integrated judicial system. So at the apex level, you have the Honorable Supreme Court of India. Okay, now at the top apex level in the Supreme Court of India, you have the Chief Justice of India. Okay, now the current Chief Justice of India have named as Sarad A. Bobde. Okay, now he is going to retire on 23rd of April. So his retirement date is 23rd of April. Okay, as per the convention, right, the central government or the law ministry basically asked the outgoing Chief Justice of India to recommend the name of the new Chief Justice of India, and that will be taken care and that will be forwarded that name to the law ministry, and that law ministry will submit that name to the cabinet, which is been headed by the Honorable Prime Minister of India, and Prime Minister, which is basically heading the cabinet, recommend the name to the President of India. And then President would basically appoint a particular judge of the Supreme Court as a Chief Justice of India. So that is the process of the appointment of the Chief Justice of India. Okay. So, you know, the Chief Justice of India, which is a current one, Sharad A. Bobde, have recommended the Justice N.V. Ramana. The N.V. Ramana, who is basically the senior most judge of the Supreme Court, okay, as the next Chief Justice of India. So current Chief Justice of India, Sharad A. Bobde, have recommended the name of the sitting judge of Supreme Court, who is N.V. Ramana, as a next Chief Justice of India, right? The Justice N.V. Ramana is also the senior most judge of Supreme Court. Okay. Now, as I told you that the Justice Sharad A. Bobde, who is currently the Chief Justice of India, would retire on 23rd of April. That means Justice N.V. Ramana, who would be the next Chief Justice of India, or 48th Chief Justice of India, would assume the charge from 24th of April 2021. Okay. Now, Center has already asked the outgoing Chief Justice of India, Sharad A. Bobde, to recommend the name of, you know, the judge of Supreme Court who will be appointed as a Chief Justice of India. And in return, the Sharad A. Bobde, who is current Chief Justice of India, has recommended the name of next Chief Justice of India, N.V. Ramana. Okay. Now, the N.V. Ramana will have short tenure. He will have the tenure of roughly more than 1 year. So that is, he will be holding the position of the Chief Justice of India till August 26, 2022. Okay. So let's understand the appointment procedure of the Chief Justice of India. So the appointment procedure of the Chief Justice of India is given under Article 124. Okay. So now you must understand Article 124 only provides you the manner in which the judges of the Supreme Court of India is appointed. Judges. Okay. But if you comes to the Chief Justice of India, there is no specific provision in our constitution that provides the appointment of a judge of Supreme Court of India as a Chief Justice of India. Okay. So Article 124 provides the appointment of, right, the judges of Supreme Court of India. Now what happens is, generally the procedure is that usually the senior most judge of the Supreme Court is alone appointed to the Chief Justice of India. But this convention have been breached in the previous time also by political parties for their political benefit. Okay. Sometimes the junior judge is also appointed as the Chief Justice of India. But the normal convention is that the senior most judge alone will be appointed as a Chief Justice of India. Okay. And general procedure is that the law minister or law ministry would seek the recommendation, right, of the current Chief Justice of India or outgoing Chief Justice of India, right, for the recommendation for the name of the new Chief Justice of India, right? So, there is also, the collegium system, right? If there is a doubt about the fitness of the senior most judge, right, who can hold the office of Chief Justice of India, right, the consultation will also be carried out with other judges of the Supreme Court of India, which is given under, Article 124, Clause 2. Okay. Now, the Law Ministry, after getting back the recommendation of the outgoing Chief Justice of India, would send those recommendations to the Prime Minister. Now, Prime Minister is basically heading your cabinet, okay, who will basically advise or who will take the decision and who would further advise the President of India on the appointment. And finally, the President basically appoint the judges of Supreme Court of India, including the Chief Justice of India. Okay. Now, if there is any doubt regarding the seniority, right, these three points will clear all sort of your doubts related to the seniority of the judges in the Supreme Court of India. So first of all, you must understand the seniority in the case of this apex court or the Supreme Court is determined not by the age, right? So it is not by the age, but by the date a judge was appointed to the Supreme Court. That means if the person was appointed to the appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court earlier, then the person who has appointed later, then in terms of age, right, or in terms of seniority, the earlier person will have, right, the seniority in the case of the appointment of the Chief Justice of India in the case of Supreme Court. All right. So here, if you compare the two persons or two judges who are elevated to the Supreme Court on the same day, right, the one who was sworn first, that means if let's say today, right, on 25th of March, the two judge A and B was appointed, if he is appointed first, right, he will have the, in terms of higher, in terms of seniority. So he will have senior than the judge B. Okay, this is the first point. Then if both are sworn as a judge on the same day, then the one with more years of high court service would win the seniority stakes. Okay, in the case, for example, if both are sworn in the same day, right, for example, on 25th of March and 26th of March, if he is appointed, obviously the A1 will have the higher in the seniority. And let's say on the same date, if both A and B is appointed, okay, on the same day. Now, how will you take care of this? You will take care of this by the number of years the judges A and B have the experience, right, as a high court judge, right? Right. So he will, or the seniority will be checked, right, the number of years, right, the judge has served the high court, right? So that will be deciding factor for the seniority in the case of the appointment of judge or in the case of seniority. Then the appointment from the bench would trump in the seniority as an appointee from the bar. Okay. So that is that, if the appointment was done from the bench, which has been set up, or it will be, appointee from the bar, that is Bar Council of India, obviously the appointment from the bench would have the higher seniority in the case of this third point. Okay. Regarding the tenure, so you must understand, there is no fixed tenure, right? For example, 5 years, 6 years, 4 years. No, this is nothing. There is no tenure. There is no term. The only thing is that once appointed to the office of the, or once appointed as a judge of Supreme Court, for example, if the person is appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court in the age of 55 years, okay, now he will be holding the office as a judge of the Supreme Court up to 65 years of his age. That means he will have the term of 10 years. In the same way, if the person is appointed at the age of 50 years in the case of the Supreme Court judge, then he will remain in the office up to 65 years. That means he will have the term of 15 years as the judge of Supreme Court. That means there is no minimum age, right, at which the person can be appointed to the judge of Supreme Court. Okay. The president can appoint those person who is recommended by the cabinet, okay, or the prime minister, and there is no minimum or cutoff age for the person before being appointed to the judge of Supreme Court, and there is no term that 5 years, 6 years, there is no such term. Once appointed, there is only one limitation, that the judge cannot hold the office beyond 65 years of his age. That means he will compulsory retire at the age of 65 years. This is the only limitation in the case of judge of Supreme Court. Okay. Next, there is also the removal process. That removal process is called impeachment process. Now, you must also understand one thing, that judges, right, of Supreme Court are appointed, okay, by the president. But they do not hold the office during the pleasure of, okay, during the pleasure of president. That means once been appointed, the president cannot remove them arbitrarily. President cannot remove them arbitrarily. There is a separate process for the removal of the judges of Supreme Court of India, okay, which is also known as the impeachment process. So it is not that the judges hold the office during the pleasure of the President of India. No, the judges do not hold the office during the President of India, during the pleasure of the President of India. Yes, it is true that judges are appointed by the President of India, but the President cannot remove the judges arbitrarily, right? There is some well-defined process of the impeachment of the judges. Only through that one, once it is completed, then only the president passes the order for the removal of the judges of Supreme Court of India. All right. So let's move to the next news. So here you will have some brief history about the Justice N.V. Ramana. So first of all, Justice N.V. Ramana was born in August 27, 1957. Okay. He was born in the agricultural family in the Poonawaran villages in the Krishna district of Andhra Pradesh. Okay. And he was enrolled as an advocate on February 10th, 1983, okay, in Andhra Pradesh itself. Then he was appointed as a permanent judge of Andhra Pradesh High Court on 27th of June 2000. Okay. And then between March 10 to May 20, 2013, he was functioning as the acting Chief Justice of the Andhra Pradesh High Court. Okay. And then on September 2, 2013, he was elevated to the Chief Justice of Delhi High Court. All right. And then on February 17, 2014, he was elevated to the Judge of Supreme Court. And since then, he is working with the Supreme Court as a Judge of Supreme Court. And now on 24th of April 2021, okay, that is the date. So on 24th of April 2021, okay, he will be appointed the next Chief Justice of India. Okay, so that is the brief history. Now, he has the diverse experience in practicing the High Courts of Andhra Pradesh, Central and Andhra Pradesh Administrative Tribunals. He was also having experience in the Supreme Court in the civil, criminal, constitutional and labor services and electoral matters. Okay, he is basically specialized in constitutional criminal service and interstate river laws. Okay. Next, the double mutant coronavirus variant. Now, this is basically a coronavirus mutant, or it is a double mutant coronavirus variant, which is been found in India, right? It is found in India. So it is a cause of concern, right? Because this combination of this mutation not seen anywhere else in the world. Okay. So it is obviously a cause of concern that a double mutation or double mutant coronavirus variant have been found in India. It has been found in almost 200 virus samples, which have been screened, right, or which have been diagnosed. Okay. Now, first of all, now you must understand there is no such study whether this double mutant coronavirus variant would increase the effectivity of the coronavirus vaccine or it would make the coronavirus more severe. Okay. There is no such study well established, you know, the scientific evidence for that. But the genomic sequences, right, which was taken or which was diagnosed with the, you know, various virus samples, right, with a consortium of 10 laboratories across the country, which is called as Indian SARS-CoV-2 Consortium on Genomics, that is called NSAC-CO, basically revealed that this double mutant coronavirus variant have been found right, which is basically, you know, have the two mutations, right, or the presence of two mutations, that is E484Q and L452R. These two mutations, or these two basically, you know, have been found together in at least 200 virus samples, which are being screened by this consortium of 10 laboratories, which is also known as Indian SARS-CoV-2 Consortium on Genomics. Okay. Now, the mutations of this virus is not surprising. It is well common, but the specific mutations, right, would definitely, you know, have the impact on the efficacy of the vaccine. So it may, first of all, you know, impede the vaccines which have been developed, or it may also impact the immune system of a person, or it may also link to the spike in the cases or increasing the cases of the coronavirus, or it can, you know, increase the severity of the disease, right? Because it's a mutation one. So the study has not been conducted with respect to this virus. So it can affect the population in the multiple way. Okay. Now, these two mutations, right, which is basically the right, two variants, have been found in the world, right, globally, but they have been found individually. So individually, they have been identified. Okay. But having identified individually, they have been associated with the reduction of vaccine efficacy, right? But what would be their combined effect if they have the mutation, that is double mutant coronavirus with that two variants, right? So their combined effect is not known. Biological implications have not been understood. So that is again the, you know, the cause of the concern. It is a matter of research on this field of the mutation of the that two variants. Okay. Now, InSecOG, which is basically, you know, basically having the consortium of 10 laboratories, would submit the details of this variant or mutation to the global repository called GISAD. Okay. Now, this would basically classify it the variants of concern. Okay. Now, so far, only three global variants have been identified. That is basically in the UK variant, which is the V.1.1.7, then South African variant, which is V.1.351, and the Brazilian one, that is P.1 lineages. Okay. Now, the India will have the fourth type. Okay. So, now once this new variant will be submitted to the global repository, okay, now this will basically categorize this new variant under the formal lineage. Okay. And that will be given based on its name. Okay. So the India will have the fourth country, or India will be the fourth country to have this variant in the global scale. Okay. Next, you have the Zawar 1 range. See, Zawar 1 range basically lies in the Jammu and Kashmir. It is lies between the Pir Panjal range and Great Himalayan ranges. Okay. Now, in the Zawar 1 range, there is Asia's largest tulip garden, which is located in the Jammu and Kashmir. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have asked everyone from every corner of the country to visit the Asia's largest tulip garden, which is located on the foothills of this Zawar 1 range, right, which is located between the Pir Panjal range and Great Himalayan range in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. This Asia's largest tulip garden will be thrown open to the public on March 25th, 2021. Okay. And this garden will have the 15 lakh followers. Okay. And that will have more than 64 variants in the bloom. Okay. So you can say 15 lakh flowers will be there in this tulip garden, and that too from 64 varieties. Okay. So regarding this Zawar 1 range, it is basically a short sub-mountain range, which has been found between the Pir Panjal range, okay, and Great Himalayan range in the central part of Kashmir Valley, right, which is obviously the newly made the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. All right. So you can see the tulip garden, right, which is the Asia's largest tulip garden, which start, you know, opening for the tourists, right, for, you know, on the Thursday, that is on 25th of March, that is from today. Okay. Next, the National Commission for Allied and Healthcare Professional Bill 2021. Now, this commission, which has been, you know, this bill, which is being passed by the parliament, that means the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha gave the nod or passed this National Commission for the Allied and Healthcare Professional Bill 2021. Now, what is that bill? The bill aims, first of all, to define the allied health professionals. Okay. Now, these allied health professionals may be an associate, may be a technician, may be a technologist, but you must understand, according to bill, such professionals should be having a diploma or degree under that bill. So obviously, to increase the scope of the medical and healthcare facilities, right, to expand those facilities to every corner of the country, right, this Commission for Allied and Healthcare Professional Bill is being passed by the parliament. Okay. Now, this bill seeks to regulate and standardize the education and the practices related to allied and healthcare professionals, which is also working in our country. Okay. So these allied and healthcare professionals can be an associate, can be a technician, or can be a technologist, but who should be trained to support, right? They should be trained, right? It's not something that they can be just simply can diagnose and can treatment do. No, they should be trained in terms of diagnosis, in terms of treatment, okay, in terms of any disease, injury, or impairment. And also, such allied healthcare professionals should have obtained the diploma or the degree under the bill for doing such, you know, diagnosis or the treatment related to any disease. Now, this bill also define who will be the healthcare professional or what is in the purview of the definition of the healthcare professional. Okay, so a healthcare professional can be a scientist, can be a therapist, can be other professional who have studied, advises, research, supervises any of the preventive medical care, curative healthcare, rehabilitative, therapeutic, promotional health services, right? And such a professional should be compulsory obtaining the degree under this bill. Okay, this bill specified the certain categories of allied and healthcare professionals, right? So these categories are also recognized categories or included in the recognized categories. These include the life science professionals, the trauma and the burn care professionals, surgical and the anesthetic professionals, okay, the physiotherapist and the nutritional science professionals. All right. And this bill would also, you know, aim to set up the National Commission for Allied and Healthcare Professional. Okay. This National Commission for Allied and Healthcare Professional would have the regulatory body that will frame the policies, okay, as well as the standard for regulating the education and the practices in India related to allied and healthcare professionals. Okay. This bill also aims to create and maintain an online central register. Okay. This online central register would have, right, you know, the names of all registered professional related to this allied and healthcare profession. Okay. And this will also provide that it will have the uniform entrance and the exit examination among the others in this allied and healthcare professionals also. Okay. Now, this commission would constitute a professional council, right? This professional council would be constituted for every recognized category that we have seen. Okay. Such recognized category of the allied and healthcare professionals, and that council would basically regulate also related to such allied and healthcare professionals also. Now, this bill also mandate that within the 6 months of the passage of the bill, okay, every state government would constitute the state allied and healthcare councils for the registration of those professionals, right, which are included in the allied and healthcare councils. Okay. Next, the CBSE rolls out the assessment framework. Okay. Now, as you have seen that, right, the government of India is basically, you know, started, you know, updating its assessment process of checking the competency of the students. Okay. Now, the Central Board of Secondary Education have rolled out the new assessment framework. This new assessment framework, right, for the class 6 to 10th studying students, okay, specifically in the English, maths, and science. through this new assessment framework rather than checking the rote knowledge or, you know, the memorizing skills, right? It will be assessing the students, right? The actual competency, okay? So that will have the unique set of the assessment procedure, okay? So under this new systems, the teachers will be trained, okay, to create a question papers and other assessment methods, right? These assessment methods would check the actual competency of the students rather than just checking the memorizing ability of the student, okay? This framework was launched by our education minister, Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank, okay? And this assessment framework would basically align with the national education policy's vision of achieving the global standard in assessments, all right? And as you know that initially, because it will be implemented in the phase-wise, right? So in the initial phase or in the first phase, this program will be implemented in the selected Kendriya Vidyalayas, okay? So the Kendriya Vidyalayas, Navodaya Vidyalayas, the CBSE schools in the Chandigarh, as well as the few private schools are included in the phase one of implementation of this new assessment framework, okay? Now, by 2024, it will be rolled out in 25,000 CBSE schools across the country, okay? And that will be benefiting 1.32 lakh teachers as well as the 2 crore students in our country. So slowly in the phase wise, it will be covering all CBSE enrolled schools. So he is basically our honorable, education minister, Ramesh Chand Pokhriyal, who has launched this CBSE assessment framework for the science, maths and English classes, right? For the students who are studying in the 6th to 10th classes, okay? For assessing the students' competency with a new framework, okay? And that will be by CBSE with Association of the British Council. All right. Next, the India's TB report, okay? Now, as you have seen that India has the high TB burden, right, among the countries. Now, in 2020, this report was basically given by the government of India or the Union Health Ministry. So it says that in 2020, there was 18.5 tuberculosis notification. That means 18.05 tuberculosis infections was reported. Okay. And that was basically a fall of 24% from 2019. Okay. So if you compare with 2019 data, 2020 data, in 2020, there was fall of 24% of this tuberculosis notification. And that report further says that this fall in the notifications in the tuberculosis, right, is basically due to the disruption that was caused by the pandemic, which is corona, okay, as it is released by the health ministry in its report called India TB report. Okay, this India TB report further says that between January and February 2020, okay, now the notifications have the outward trajectory. That means there was 6% more cases reported in the same period if you compare this data with the 2019, okay, but as a result of lockdown, okay, the notification specifically fell in the public sector, or public sector hospitals, right, that fell by 38%. If you consider with the private sector, that was the fell basically reported by 44% in the month of April and May, okay. If you consider 2019, you have 24.04 lakh TB cases. But if you have seen the previous slide, in 2020, you have just 18.05. There was decline of 24%. So 18.05 lakh, the new cases that was reported in 2020. So that was clearly declined, right, from 2019 data. So that is around 24% decline, okay, that we have seen, okay. And the mortality rate was basically 4%, and the treatment that was successful for those TB, you know, patients was 82%. So 82% people who were basically treated as a tuberculosis, right, they have treated well, right? So the successful treatment was done to the 82% of the infected people. The mortality rate was 4%. That means 4% people died, and the 4% people lost due to the follow-up, and due to the treatment failure that was occurred, and due to the regime change after initiation of the treatment, that was around 3%. Okay, regarding budget for, you know, this controlling this tuberculosis, okay, the budget was basically initially in 2016-17, you see, it was only 640 crore in 2016-17, but subsequently it has increased to 3,333 crore in 2019-20, but which has further declined to 3,110 crore in 2020-21. Okay, so in 2020-21, the budget was 3,110 crore for containing this tuberculosis from India. Okay, now this TV report further says that the 95% of all the cases reported were initiated on the treatment in 2019-20. Okay, and success rate for the treatment of the patients in 2019 was 82%. Right. In this 82%, the 83% basically in the public sector or 79% in the private sector. In basically in 2019, there was report was 20,892. That is 42% of the patients were initiated in the shorter, you know, the multi-drug resistant tuberculosis regime, right, at the time of diagnosis. Okay. This is a significant decline if you compare this data from 2019. With the 2020. Okay. Next, the special purpose acquisition companies, that is called SPACs. Now, these special purpose acquisition companies are basically are those companies who basically, you know, raise the money from the public and who basically invest this money in certain companies or acquiring certain, you know, the firm. So they are called special purpose acquisition companies, because they raise the money and acquire certain funds. But the US Security and Exchange Commission, right, have warned regarding, you know, this, the special purpose acquisition companies, because there are a lot of the fake companies who are basically, you know, raising the money from the public and getting bankrupt because they are not for the particular purpose. Okay. So they, the US Security and Exchange Commission have warned the investors, right, related to the special purpose acquisition companies. Okay, so what is this special purpose acquisition companies? They are the blank check company. Blank check company means they are entirely set up, okay, with the objective of acquiring a firm, right, in a particular sector. So their main purpose is to acquire the firm. So that is why they are called blank check company. Okay, how would they acquire the firm? First, their procedure is, first of all, they will raise the money from the public. How will they raise the money? Through the initial public offering, that is also called IPO. Okay, so they would raise through, you know, the initial public offerings. And then, right, you must also understand, at that point of the time when they are raising money, they don't have any operations or the revenue. That means they are entirely dependent on the IPOs for raising this money. Secondly, once this money is being raised from the public, right, this money is will basically kept in the escrow account. Okay, and this escrow account can be assessed, right, while making this acquisition of a particular firm. Now, there is a provision that if that acquisition is not made within 2 years of the raising of money through the IPO, right, what will happen? This, the special purpose acquisition companies would basically return, or first of all, the special purpose acquisition company would be delisted, and whatever money they have kept in the escrow account, that money would be returned to the investors after completion of 2 years if they have not acquired a particular firm. So that is the, in the legal parlance, there is some procedure for that. And certain people also says that, you know, these companies are basically do certain transactions, right, through initial public offering and then acquiring certain firm, right, and they are basically procedure or is a medium to convert a private company can be a public traded company. So a private company can become a public traded company, obviously with certain set of control over, you know, certain set of, you know, with a process called initial public offering. Okay, the next is Suez Canal. So you must understand, the Suez Canal is basically a man-made canal, okay, which is been connecting, you know, the Mediterranean Sea with the Red Sea. Okay, this Suez Canal is a critical shipping artery. That means it is basically the canal which is carry over 12% of the world trade by volume. If you consider, there is a huge traffic in this Suez Canal. Now, what happens is, right, this Suez Canal passes through the Egypt, which connects the Mediterranean Ocean with the Red Sea. Now, this Suez Canal in the news because it blocked down after a ship or cargo ship basically ran around while passing through it, okay, which has led to the blockage of the Suez Canal and which has led to the traffic in the Vizhy trade route to the halt, okay. So it is a human-made waterway, right, which passes through the Egypt, okay, and it is the world most heavily used shipping lanes, which carry around 12% of the world trade by the volume. Okay, regarding the Suez Canal, it has been built in 1869, okay, and it is basically provides or cut down the distance, okay, that will be covered by the ships, right, between Europe and Asia. So instead of circling the Africa and then reaching to the Europe from Asia, right, this would just cutting down the distance between the Europe and Asia, right, and now they have to sail around, right, instead of sailing around the Africa to complete the journey, they can easily enter, right, and easily connect this Mediterranean Ocean with the Red Sea and easily can get enter into the Europe. Okay, now it has been built in 1869, so it is 150 year old canal. Now it was controlled by the British and the French interest, right, in the initial years, but since it is passed through the Egypt's, you know, territory, so it has been nationalized in 1956 by Egypt. Okay, that leader of the Egypt, that was the Gamal Abdel Nasser, who basically nationalized this, the Suez Canal. Okay, now this canal since then have been widened and deepened for accessing the more traffic through this Suez Canal. Okay, now the Egypt in 2015 announced the plan for further expand the Suez Canal, right? Obviously, the expansion is basically aimed at the reduction of the waiting time for the ships and also increasing the capacity of the Suez Canal to double the number of ships that can be used, right? Or that are using this canal daily by 2023. Okay, so you can see here the Suez Canal, so which is connecting basically your Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea, and it has been connected through the Egypt. Now it is being controlled by the Egypt. Okay. Next, you have Shigmo. Now the Shigmo is basically, you know, a festival, or it is a, you know, a celebration which is being celebrated by a tribal communities of Goa. So you can say it has been a festival or carnival which is being held every year in the month of February. Okay, it is a vibrant celebration which is being celebrated in the auspicious occasion of the golden harvest of paddy by the tribal communities of Goa. Okay, now as you know that the corona pandemic has not been gone, so COVID-19 has put a blanket ban or has put a suspicion whether this Shigmo would be held or not. So the questions have been raised over the scale of the celebration for annual Shigmo Utsav. Okay, so the Goa Carnival, which has been held, right, in the month of February. So Shigmo is basically in the language of Konkani, which is a language of the Goa, is another vibrant celebration with celebrated with the full color songs, dances, right, specifically in the Goan culture and traditions. Okay, and Shigmo is basically a celebration which is a, you know, harvest of paddy. It will be celebrated by the tribal communities of the Goa. Okay, including various tribal communities, including the agricultural communities, which basically also celebrate this carnival or this Shigmo. These agricultural communities are basically the Kunvis, Gowdas, Velips. Okay, this celebrate this festival, right? It is also marked the onset of spring, right? After, completing of your summer. So it is the onset of the spring. So it is celebrations over the fortnight in the month of Fagun Chaitra. That Fagun Chaitra, if you consider in the Hindu calendar, it is correspond to the month of March and April every year. Okay, and various folk dances, right, which has been also organized. So that is Gode Modini, which is a dance of, you know, equestrian warriors, was basically conducted. Then you have the Gofa and Fugdi, was also many such dance which are performed by the communities, specifically the agriculture community, tribal communities in the Goan culture and Goan perspective. Okay, you can see one such dance by a performer. Okay, next, the tiger relocation project. So now you must understand the tiger relocation project was started in 2018. Okay, now the tiger was relocated from Madhya Pradesh to the Odisha. Okay, in order to breed the more number of tigers, or in order to increase the number of tigers, okay, in the state of Odisha, or specifically, you know, in the tiger reserve of Odisha, that is in Satkosia Tiger Reserve, which is located in the Odisha. But that project ran into the trouble and ultimately it was suspended, right? So a Sundari, which is a tigress name, which was shifted from the Madhya Pradesh, that is from Kanha Tiger Reserve, right? It has been shifted to basically, you know, your Satkosia Tiger Reserve, which is in Odisha. Now it has returned to its home, right? Since this project ran into the trouble and it was basically suspended. So this 5 years old tigress, which is known as Sundari, have spent 28 months in the captivity in the Satkosia Tiger Reserve, which is located in the Odisha. And she was sent, right, to the Odisha in this Satkosia Tiger Reserve to increase the population of the tigers, right? As I told you that this interstate translocation project or tiger relocation project was started in 2018, right, when the two cats were basically, you know, relocated to this Satkosia Tiger Reserve, which is being located in the Odisha. So the two cats, the one is basically, you know, your Sundari, which is being taken from the Bandhavgarh, the tiger reserve from Madhya Pradesh, and the male one, which is known as the Mahavir, is basically taken from the Kanha Tiger Reserve. The Kanha Tiger Reserve is also in Madhya Pradesh. So these have been, relocated to Satkosia Tiger Reserve, which is located in the Odisha, right? For obviously to increasing the population of the tiger in the Satkosia Tiger Reserve. But what happens is, right, these six tigers, that is three pairs from the different reserves of the Madhya Pradesh that was sent to the Odisha under this project after that. Okay, to ultimate aim of the project is to augment and to recover the tiger population in the Satkosia Tiger Reserve. Okay, but this project ran into the trouble, okay, within the weeks of the initiation. And what happens is, subsequently, this project was suspended by the National Tiger Conservation Authority. Okay, and then these tigers and the tigresses, which was sent to the Satkosia Tiger Reserve in the Odisha, was basically returned back to the Madhya Pradesh. Okay, so you can see the tiger, who is basically looking so, you know, beautiful, you know, drinking the water in the pond. Okay, so that's all for the today. Thank you very much. We will meet again tomorrow for next current affairs. Thank you.